Hey guys, this is Dom from Tech Advisor, and I'm here to give you our pick of the best flagship phones you can buy right now. The time I'm recording this, it's May 2021, and we've had the full wave of spring flagships for this year. I mean, we've now got the nice, calm summer lull before Apple turns up in September and we get the whole new wave of new phones all over again. But for now, we've had brand new phones over the last few months from the likes of Xiaomi, Oppo, and Samsung. So here is my pick from those phones and the phones from the end of 2020. Which ones are the best for you right now and why? So, in no particular order, the first phone I want to talk about today is the iPhone 12. Yeah, the iPhone 12. You know a lot about the iPhone 12. It's Apple. It's an iPhone. It's all been said before. This is also the oldest phone on this list because, of course, it came out last September. So it is a good 6 months old, even more than that now, but still we only get iPhones once a year other than little surprises like the SEs. So we're not expecting an update until this September. The thing is, the iPhone 12 is still fantastic. It's probably the best flagship iPhone we've had in years, thanks to a few key design and technological upgrades. We've had a change to the more straight-edged angular design that calls back to older iPhones, which means that it has a lot of nostalgic appeal. I think people struggle with that on the larger 12 Pro Max, but on the 12, and especially the 12 Mini, that angular design still really works, and it makes the iPhone 12 feel different and still feel modern while simultaneously nostalgic, which is a really neat design trick Apple has pulled off. From a tech perspective, you're getting the new A14 Bionic, which means blazing fast performance, as you'd expect from a new iPhone. You're also finally getting an OLED screen, which is the first in one of the standard iPhones we had in the Pro before, but not in the standard generic main iPhone. And it is a big step up along with a big resolution upgrade as well. Though note, you are still limited to 60 Hertz rather than some of the faster refresh rates I'm gonna see on the Android flagships I'm going to talk about next. Camera is another big strength for Apple always. The downside is you're only getting a main and an ultra-wide. There's no zoom lens. You've got to go for a pro if you want to get that. But still, the main and the ultra-wide here are as phenomenal as ever, and even better in low light than they used to be. The other big downside, a really common one for Apple, unfortunately, is battery and charging. It is better than before, but still, this is a kind of just about full-day phone, but not by a lot. And we will see other Android phones that last longer. You're also getting much more slow charging, no super fast charging here, but you are getting wireless, and you have that nifty new MagSafe tech if you want to take advantage of that. It would be unfair to talk about Apple without talking about their biggest global competitor in Samsung. Samsung obviously has a few phones in the S21 series, and while I love the regular S21, the one I want to highlight here is the S21 Ultra. That is to my surprise, because I thought the S20 Ultra last year was rubbish. But the S21 Ultra is really fantastic if it's your sort of thing. The caveat there is the size. It's a 6.8 inch display and the rest of the phone around it is pretty big too. This boy is chonky. But Samsung has done their best to keep the bezel slim, keep the phone from being too thick, and also thanks to its redesigned camera module, that bit actually feels kind of slender. It wraps right around the edges of the phone and it's kind of weird to look at a camera module that big and still say it feels slim, but it does. They've pulled it off and credit to them. Speaking of that camera module, it is pretty phenomenal. You're getting a 108 megapixel main camera, you get a 3x zoom and a 10x periscope zoom, and you get the wide angle. This is perhaps the best camera you can get in a phone right now. Probably the closest competitor is the Xiaomi Mi 11 Ultra, but you're getting a much bigger camera module with the Mi 11 Ultra. And honestly, they're so close on performance. You're getting higher resolution with the Samsung, slightly bigger sensor with the Xiaomi. It's very close to call, but the fact of the matter is, this is a phenomenal camera setup and it is very, very, very hard for anyone else to beat it. The display is another big strength here. I've already mentioned it's big at 6.8 inches, but it's also OLED. It's 120 Hertz, so double the refresh rate of the iPhone I've spoken about. And it's got the benefit of dynamic refresh rate. We're gonna see that again on some other phones here, but basically that means the refresh rate can scale up and down dynamically to the content you're watching, which importantly means it can save battery life by going to a lower refresh rate when you're looking at static images or lower frame rate videos and stuff like that. Also for this year, we have S Pen support on the S21 Ultra, that's Samsung's stylus. It's worth noting it doesn't come included with the phone, and also there's no slot in the phone for it to slide into. But you can buy an official case that has an S Pen slot for it, but still, it means if you're sad there's no Note 21 coming later this year and you're a big fan of Samsung stylus, the S21 Ultra is there for you. It will work with that. And one of the final weak point I really want to talk about here is charging. So there is both wired and wireless charging, but the speeds they cap out are relatively low compared to a lot of the rest of the Android competition. And the other thing here, shared with the iPhone, is there is no charger in the box. Samsung has followed Apple in that. So if you don't already own a decent USB-C charger that's compatible, you will go have to buy one yourself. Speaking of fast charging, the next phone I want to discuss is the Xiaomi Mi 11. I've already mentioned the Mi 11 Ultra, but for my money, I think the sweet spot in Xiaomi's new line is in the standard Mi 11, which I think will work a lot better for a lot more people and costs quite a bit less. This is actually still a big phone. It's 6.8 inch screen, the same size as the S21 Ultra, and in fact the same size as the Mi 11 Ultra, but the rest of the phone is a lot slimmer. The camera module is a lot smaller, so it does feel more petite. It's also lighter. It still comes in under 200 grams, unlike those two Ultra phones. You're still getting an OLED panel with 120 hertz refresh rate, and the whole thing is powered by the Snapdragon 888, the fastest chipset you're going to find on the Android side of the market, at least. You also get that same 108 megapixel main camera that we discussed in the S21 Ultra. So you've got this super high resolution main camera, and along with that, you get a wide angle and a macro lens, but you're not getting any zoom lens whatsoever, not even a 2x or a 3x, certainly no periscope. That is a big omission, and I know it is going to be a deal breaker for some people. I mentioned charging, and that is definitely one of the other big strengths here. Wire charging, 55 watts. Wireless charging may be even more impressive at 50 watts, so almost as fast. Though to be fair, you'll only get that kind of speed if you buy the official Xiaomi charger. You're not gonna get that off a standard Qi pad. There is one final drawback to the Mi 11 I do wanna mention, maybe a controversial one, but it's MIUI. That's Xiaomi's Android software overlay. I admit I don't love it. I know it has its fans. For me, I find MIUI clunky, kind of ugly, difficult to navigate compared to a lot of the other Android alternatives. So I would say if you've not used MIUI before, maybe try and check it out on a friend's phone or in a shop, see what you think, because it does put me off using Xiaomi phones at least. Next up, the Oppo Find X3 Pro, which when I reviewed, I said would probably be the most striking looking phone of the year. And so far, I'm pretty sure I'm still right. I haven't seen anything yet that looks quite like the Find X3 Pro. Oppo went back to the drawing board for the design of the rear of this phone and managed to curve the glass up to and over the camera module, so this one seamless piece of glass that wraps around the whole back of the phone. The effect is genuinely really stunning, and I don't think it looks as good in photos as it actually does in real life. I didn't love it when I first saw it, and then when I got the phone in my hands, absolutely fell for it. I think the Find X3 Pro is really, really stunning, and it is special. Of course, if you're gonna slap a case on it, that might not matter to you very much. But if you don't use a case on your phone, really look at this, because it is a beautifully designed piece of hardware, and that's gotta be one of its big strengths. The display is another one. Oppo went all in on display last year, and they've done the same here. It's a touch smaller than the last two phones. That's 6.7 inches, though that's still a pretty big screen. 120 hertz, just like them. It's got that same adaptive display refresh rate technology that I spoke about in the Samsung, so it can drop the refresh rate down now to slow it down and save battery life when it needs to. Just as importantly, it's all in 10-bit color. And Oppo this year has gone big on the idea that it has true 10-bit, which means the camera captures in 10-bit, files are stored and encoded and decoded in 10-bit, and then displayed on the screen in 10-bit. If you care, that could be really, really important. I think for the average user, this doesn't really matter. You're gonna take photos, they're gonna look nice, they're gonna look nice on the screen. That's kind of what it comes down to. But if you are a creative professional and you want your phone to be one of the tools you use in your kit, and that kind of stuff matters, this is a pretty unique phone in the marketplace for that, at least. Like the Xiaomi and the Samsung, depending on the market for the Samsung, it runs a Snapdragon 888 chipset. Charging is also super, super impressive. 65 watt wired charging, even faster than the Xiaomi, among the fastest you can get in the West at least. Slightly slower 30 watt wireless, though still really impressive. The camera is also really worth talking about. It's a pretty unique camera module in a few ways. First up, the main lens and the ultra wide lens are both 50 megapixel. They both use the same Sony IMX766 sensor. they basically get shots that come out almost identical in terms of color and exposure. That is fantastic. It gives the camera a real versatility because you can dive between the main lens and the ultra wide in almost any lighting conditions and still be happy with the shots you're getting out of both. In low light, it will vary a little bit just because they're at different apertures. But really, you have to push it to pull these two sensors apart. And I love that because it's so frustrating to me using other phones when I take a shot with the main camera and then think, oh, I want to get this like wide angle. I want to get more of the scene in. You switch and what you're getting out of the wide angle just isn't the same. The sky's a different color. The light's gone wrong, especially if it's low light, suddenly everything's blown out. You're not going to get that with this phone. Unlike the Xiaomi, you do get a zoom lens, but it's only a 2x zoom, so no big periscope. Instead of a periscope, you get what Oppo calls a micro lens. This is a gimmick, to be blunt, but it's a very cool gimmick. Basically, this is a microscope. You can put it right up against surfaces, against objects, and get microscopic shots. You can take photos of the cell walls of a leaf and the like individual fibers of a piece of clothing. It is very cool. It's like macro photography amped up to the nth degree. I don't know if you're ever going to use this all the time. It's not going to help you take great holiday snaps. You're not going to get good food shots for Instagram using it. But if you like to play around with interesting photography, this is, again, genuinely unique. The Oppo Find X3 Pro does something that no other phone on the market does right now. And I do think it deserves credit for that. Last but certainly not least, we have the Vivo X60 Pro. This sits in the middle of Vivo's X60 flagship range. There's also a standard X60 and an X60 Pro Plus, but the Pro is my preferred model of the three. It's the only one of these Android phones I've mentioned that runs on the Snapdragon 870 rather than the 888, which you'd find in the Pro Plus. But the 870 is still great. You're still getting 5G support like every other phone I've talked about today. And because it's basically a year old flagship but overclocked, you're still getting flagship level performance. It's just a little bit behind 888 phones. But unless you're a competitive mobile gamer, I promise you, you will not notice the difference. One of my favorite things about the X60 series, and especially the X60 and the Pro, is the design. Vivo has been knocking out of the park for the last few years with its flagships, and this is no exception. The display runs a little bit smaller than some of the others I've spoken about here at 6.56 inches, though that is still a pretty large display by most people's standards, I think. What's nice is the phone is very slim at only 7.6 millimeters, and it's light at 179 grams. So what you're getting is still a pretty big phone in terms of the display you're getting, but it's slim and it's light. That makes it means it feels portable, it's comfortable to use in one hand, even for extended periods. And there's just something about it that looks and feels really, really nice and comfortable. Again, it's one of those things, you see it in the photos, you think, yeah, that looks nice. You've got to pick this phone up and use it and you will see what I mean. It is one of my favorite design phones of the year so far. And like pretty much every phone I've spoken about today, the camera is worth discussing. It is interesting in its own right. You're getting a triple rear camera setup here. There's a 13 megapixel wide angle and a 13 megapixel 2x zoom, what Vivo calls a portrait lens. But the star is the 48 megapixel main shooter. This is mostly interesting because it has the support of the gimbal tech that Vivo introduced on the X50 Pro last year. This is the next level up of optical image stabilization, basically keeping your lens perfectly stable by moving the lens about in response to the way the phone itself is moving. What this means is that even if you have shaky hands, you're going to get really crisp, steady shots, crisp, steady, stable video, and any nighttime low light photography is going to be really improved because for those long exposures, the phone will keep the lens steadier. So although this doesn't have as big a sensor as some of the other phones I've spoken about, which is a really key point for nighttime photography, the X60 Pro punches above its weight anyway because it's got that souped up stabilization. What I really want to see next year from Vivo is that gimbal tech applied to a bigger sensor, because that would be hands down the best low light photography you'd get on a phone. So I'm hoping they're working on that. As with all these other phones though, there are a few little flaws. Charging isn't the best, you're getting 33 watt wired, but there is no wireless charging whatsoever. It is the only one of these five flagships I've spoken about today that just does not support wireless charging. And that is really frustrating when you're in the flagship space. Vivo hasn't done any wireless charging yet, and my God, they need to. It's also the only one of these phones that doesn't have an official IP rating. Vivo does say it has some water resistance, but they haven't paid for an IP rating, so we don't know how intense that water resistance is. So you won't have all that peace of mind you might get with the others that you know you can drop it in the bath and it'll be fine. final thing is, similar to Xiaomi, software's not my favorite. If you get the phone from China, if you import a Chinese model or you're in China, then you're gonna get it running the new Origin OS software, which I haven't tried out. The rest of the world gets FunTouch OS. I do not like FunTouch OS. It's maybe my least favorite Android skin. If you buy it in Europe, you will get still FunTouch OS, but a really stripped back version of FunTouch OS that's very close to stock Android. So if you're in Europe and the UK, this complaint doesn't apply because you'll actually be getting basically stock Android. But if you're anywhere else in the world, or if you're importing a model from India or something like that, then you are gonna get FunTouch and I don't like it. Okay, so that's what we think are the top five flagship phones for spring 2021. The iPhone 12, the Galaxy S21 Ultra, the Xiaomi Mi 11, the Oppo Find X3 Pro, and the Vivo X60 Pro. But I wanna know what you guys think. Did I get it wrong? Should I put the Pixel 5 in here? Should I have put the OnePlus 9 or 9 Pro in here? Because I didn't really like them that much, but I know a lot of you guys did. Jump in the comments, let me know what you think I got wrong here, which flagship phones you would recommend someone out there buy, and what you think I should be looking out for the updated version of this video in the autumn. Thanks very much, and remember to like and subscribe. Big omission for some, and might be a bit of a deal killer. That's not the phrase, what's the phrase?
Deal breaker.
Deal breaker, thank you.